Dear friends, welcome once again in the teleconference session of Postgraduate Diploma in Clinical Cardiology. Today we are here to discuss about the mitral stenosis and mitral regurgitation. And to discuss this very important topic, we have got experts from National Heart Institute. Extremely my left, Dr. Tushar Roy. He is the consultant cardiologist in that institution. And next to me is Dr. Rekha Mishra. She is a consultant cardiologist in the non-invasive cardiology. Now, before going to the topic, there are few information I would like to share with you is regarding your course material. Actually, we are very extremely sorry that we are not able to provide right now the course material, and expecting that within 2 weeks we can provide you a few course material. And for that, we want the total number of students in each one of your institution, mentioning the first year as well as second number of student. You can send me this information to my email or by letter. So this is the one type of homework I am giving to you. And as soon as we receive the total number of student, we can send all the books in the name of your program in charges. This is the first announcement. Second announcement, I would like to announced regarding this result of your June 2007 examination. Although previous teleconference we said that it will take 3 months or so, but expecting within 1 month or so we can display your result in the internet. So these are the two important announcement I would like to share with you. Now coming into the topic, as all of us we know that this valvular heart disease is the one of the most common heart disease in our country, and among them mitral regurgitation is the most common one. Today in this sessions we will discuss first session about the clinical pathology, physiopathology and clinical features of the mitral stenosis as well as mitral regurgitation. In the second session we will discuss about the diagnostic criteria, that is mainly covered the echocardiography, although we have got extensive sessions on this echocardiography on these two diseases. And in the our third session we will discuss about the management of these two diseases. Dear friends, all of you know that mitral valve is situated in the left side of the heart between the left atrium as well as and left ventricle, and mitral regurgitation is the one of the most common valvular heart disease observed in our clinical practice. And mitral stenosis is basically mainly dominated in the all the developing country because of rheumatic heart disease. 50% of them, they cannot recall the history, but still it is the one of the major cause of this mitral stenosis. So I will request Dr. Tushar Roy to discuss about this mitral stenosis as well as mitral regurgitation in details. Thank you.
Good morning, fellow students. And I call you fellow students because we are still learning. And I hope I will keep, and we will all keep learning till the moment that we leave this world. Today we are going to discuss a very important topic, and that is mitral stenosis and mitral regurgitation. In the first session, we are going to discuss the clinical features, the symptoms, and how we diagnose it, except for echocardiography. Then Rekha will talk about echocardiography, and finally we'll have a session on how to manage this disease. So mitral stenosis basically means narrowing of the mitral valve. And we know the mitral valve normally has a size of about 4 to 5 centimeters square. However, we've still got some reserve, and therefore actually symptoms don't start appearing till they become about 2.5 centimeter square or smaller. So only after the valve becomes 2.5 centimeters or smaller does a patient start then experiencing symptoms. And we call it mild if the area is between 1.5 and 2.5 centimeters square, which would mean a mean gradient across the mitral valve of about 5 millimeters and a pulmonary capillary wedge pressure of about 10 millimeters. moderate if it is between 1 and 1.5 centimeters, which would mean a mean gradient of about 5 to 10 millimeters mercury across the valve, and a pulmonary capillary wedge pressure which has now started elevating between 10 and 17 millimeters of mercury, and severe or critical if it is less than 1 centimeter square, which would mean a gradient of about more than 10 millimeters across the mitral valve, a mean gradient, not a peak gradient, and a pulmonary capillary wedge pressure which is more than 18 and now approaching 20, which means that even minimal activity will now cause breathlessness in this patient. And if you look at this, the left picture shows us a normal mitral valve. We are looking at the heart from the top. The valve right in front is the pulmonary valve, and behind that is the aortic valve. And on the left lower portion is the mitral valve. You can see very clearly that it's a large mitral valve. And the right valve, which is the largest valve you can see, is the tricuspid valve. However, the right picture shows you that the valve has narrowed. This is to give you a three-dimensional appreciation of what we are talking about. Because in all the echocardiography and everything, we'll be seeing a two-dimensional or an ice pick view. But here we can appreciate how narrow the valve has to become before actually symptoms then start appearing. So what is the pathophysiology? What actually happens? It's obvious that when the valve starts narrowing, the left atrial pressure then starts building. And then as the left atrial pressure starts building, the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and the pulmonary venous pressure starts increasing. And this leads to actually interstitial edema. So when there is interstitial edema, the patient may be quite comfortable at rest. But then as he starts exercising, walking about, climbing stairs, then he starts getting breathless. And as the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure goes on increasing further and further, they may actually cause alveolar flooding and may come to us with frank, what we say, pulmonary edema. Not left ventricular failure, because the ventricle is normal, but pulmonary edema because the alveoli are now flooded with water. However, as a compensatory mechanism, the lymphatic drainage starts increasing. So part of this flooding or interstitial edema is now drained away by this increasing process of increase in lymphatic drainage. So certain adaptations then start occurring other than lymphatic drainage, and that is initially there will be pulmonary vascular constriction. So the muscles actually then start constricting. And the importance of this is to realize that it is a reversible process, because if the muscles are contracting, then it's a reversible process. Once you treat the disease, it will become normal. But then what happens is, over a period of time, actually intimal and muscle hypertrophy and hyperplasia starts occurring, and then you get what is known as a permanent or a fixed pulmonary artery hypertension, where the patient may not revert back totally to normal if even after the thing is corrected. Causes. For all practical purposes, the cause is rheumatic. There is no other cause other than rheumatic heart disease as far as mitral stenosis is concerned. For theoretical purposes, we have to list other causes, but they could be congenital, diseases like SLE or rheumatoid arthritis, amyloidosis, malignant carcinoid, large vegetations or LA myxoma can all cause mitral stenosis. But as I said, for all practical purposes, it is rheumatic and only rheumatic. So how do we then go about and diagnose mitral stenosis? Obviously, we have to follow a pattern, and the pattern is very simple. We first take a history that will act as pointers. We do a physical examination, have a look at the very, very commonly and easily available tools of ECG and X-ray. And of course, another very common and easily available tool of echocardiography. As far as cardiac catheterization is concerned, its importance has, of course, decreased drastically in the last few years. And we'll only be discussing some points of it. So as far as the history is concerned, of course, the primary, as I said, the most important cause is rheumatic fever. And we have to take a history of rheumatic fever, its manifestations. But I must remind you that it may be absent, or the patient may not remember, or it may have been very mild in nature for the patient to appreciate it. It may have been too early in the course of his disease. He may have been a child. So you may not get a history of rheumatic fever in about 50% of the cases. So half the time you may not get a history of fever, but that does not mean that the process is not rheumatic. Almost always the process is rheumatic as far as mitral stenosis is concerned. The earliest feature that they will get is, of course, breathlessness. Starting when the interstitial edema starts occurring, when the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure starts rising, then you get breathlessness on effort initially, and then with more and lesser effort you get breathless, and frankly you will then become orthopneic. By the meaning orthopnea we mean that the patient will not be able to lie flat in bed and would require elevation of the head end to be comfortable and not be breathless. This is orthopnea. And then we have the classical PND, or paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. Paroxysmal means coming off and on, nocturnal at night, and breathlessness is dyspnea. What actually happens is that the patient goes off to sleep 3 to 4 hours. It doesn't have to be the night, it could be in the afternoon also. But after 3 to 4 hours, when all the fluid that is there in the body gets absorbed into the vascular system, the patient then gets breathlessness because there's alveolar interstitial edema, alveolar flooding, and the patient gets paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. This is a classical example and has to be taken extremely seriously, because now the reserve that anybody has is now getting exhausted. And this would mean a very, very advanced disease. The patient may also have palpitation. Under normal circumstances, they will not have palpitation because it's in sinus rhythm. But when the patient develops atrial fibrillation, a fast ventricular rate, which can happen in about 30-40% of cases of mitral stenosis, very common complication of mitral stenosis, one can present with palpitation also. Unusual presentations, which we used to see much in the past, but we don't see now so much nowadays, simply because we diagnose the condition early, are hemoptysis. Very commonly we used to see in the past, angina even, and that angina could be a typical angina, but it is because of severe pulmonary artery hypertension, because now it is the RV that is not getting the blood, so the RV muscles are not getting blood, and that can result in angina. Hoarseness of voice, because the left recurrent laryngeal nerve gets compressed by the dilating left atrium. You can have dysphagia. The same left atrial dilatation causes pressure on the esophagus, may cause dysphagia, and they all have names associated with them. And the crux of the thing is that with the onset of severe pulmonary artery hypertension, that is a pulmonary systolic pressure more than 60 millimeters of mercury, whereas normally the normal pulmonary systolic pressure is about 30 or less, the whole thing then becomes is that the mean survival, unless treated by surgical or intervention means, is only about less than 3 years, and that's very important. Physical examination, as far when we examine the patient and look at the physical signs, Western textbooks write malar flush, but they are all seen in the West. I've been to the West, and we have seen patients of malar flush, but we are of slightly darker skinned persons, so malar flush for all practical purposes we have not seen at all. Of course, as the pulmonary artery pressure starts rising, we get elevated JVP. So the JVP as such starts elevating. That means the patient has started to have congestive heart failure. Initially, the right atrium will pump very powerfully, so you get a very prominent A wave, and then ultimately the patient will have tricuspid regurgitation. When the RV will start failing, when the RV will start dilating, then you can have a very prominent V wave. So that is the progression that it occurs. A wave initially, followed by V wave. You can have hepatomegaly when patient starts having congestive heart failure, and of course finally pedal edema. Even before these stages, when you have a borderline JVP, not much hepatomegaly, no pedal edema, you can get a finding called hepatojugular reflux, in which we give a general pressure over the upper part of the abdomen, maybe over the right side, but some people say the right side should be avoided because the liver is there, you might cause pain while pressing over that. So general pressure over the epigastrium or upper abdomen for about a minute or so will cause the JVP to raise by about 1 centimeter. How we do that? Because the rise in JVP is very, very slow and gradual. So basically, we give the pressure for about a minute or two and then suddenly relax the pressure. When we suddenly relax the pressure, the JVP falls by 1 centimeter. So thereby telling us that the JVP has actually risen by 1 centimeter. And this could help us pick up an incipient heart failure, where we don't really have to wait for the JVP to rise, the liver to enlarge. We know that the patient is going into heart failure. We know even clinically that the pulmonary artery pressure is high, even before we've actually auscultated the patient. Now we start examining the heart of the patient. We look at the apex of the heart, the apical impulse, and we find that the apical impulse is in normal position. That means the heart is not enlarged as such, because the left ventricle is absolutely normal in size. The characteristic thing is that has been described is that it could be characterized as tapping. Now tapping basically is your fingers feeling the loud first heart sound. So that's what we call a tapping apical impulse in its normal position, no other specific character. And as the pulmonary artery pressure increases, we can have a parasternal heave, which is caused by the right ventricle, which is now forcefully contracting because of the rise in pulmonary artery pressure. We have what is known as a parasternal heave, which will be forceful and well sustained, a parasternal heave. And finally, when we put our fingers in the second left intercostal space, we will actually be able to feel the pulmonary artery pulsation. So systolic pulsation in the pulmonary area, a systolic pulsation, so we can actually feel the pulmonary artery because of the high pressure, and in the diastole we can actually feel an impulse, which is the P2, a palpable P2, which we can feel. So these are all the findings on physical examination of the patient. And now the auscultatory findings: a loud first heart sound, a very loud first heart sound is a classical feature of mitral stenosis. And in fact, just by that listening through the first heart sound, one can come to the conclusion that the patient has mitral stenosis. An opening snap, which will of course be in diastole following the second heart sound, which is best heard with the bell of the stethoscope, and often best heard in between the apex and the sternal border, not classically at the apical position. And of course we have the classical mid-diastolic rumbling murmur, a low-pitched murmur, mid-diastolic, and sometimes as the severity increases and if the patient is in sinus rhythm, we can also have a presystolic accentuation. And of course, all this is best heard if you turn the patient on the left side, if you ask the patient to lie down after some kind of exercise, and if he holds his breath after expiration. So the classical features are that you'll get a loud first heart sound. So you'll hear something like rubda, rubda, rubda. The rub will be very, very, very loud and very fast. And then you'll hear the opening stab, rubdakak, rubdakak, rubdakak. That's how you'll hear it. And then you'll hear a mid-diastolic rumble, rub-da-gug-drrr, and then you'll hear a pre-systolic accentuation, rub-da-gug-rrr-rup. So that's the rup is the pre-systolic accentuation. And this will be the classical feature. If you hear it in a slow heart rate, you will never, 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 ever be able to forget this kind of a murmur. And of course, as the physical findings, as the complexity of the disease will increase, we'll find that you've got a loud pulmonary sound, a loud P2. You can even have pulmonary regurgitation, which is called the classical Gram-Steele murmur. And you can even have a mid-systolic, ejection-systolic murmur in the pulmonary area, which is again indicates that the patient is having severe pulmonary artery hypertension. You may even hear a pulmonary ejection sound, or also called a pulmonary click, which is best heard in the lower parts of the parasternal area, best heard. And the classical feature of this pulmonary ejection sound is that all sounds of the heart of the right side, originating from the right side, increase with inspiration, except for pulmonary ejection sound, which decreases with inspiration. So this is a classical feature of a pulmonary ejection sound that you'll be able to hear in advanced cases of pulmonary artery hypertension. And of course, as the advancement will occur, you'll initially have a right ventricular fourth heart sound, which is basically a vigorously pumping right atrium, and then finally when the right ventricular starts failing, you may even have a right ventricular third heart sound. So that is the progression of the disease as it occurs. You'll have an opening snap, mid-diastolic murmur, presystolic accentuation. Finally, the evidence of pulmonary artery hypertension in the form of P2 increasing, diastolic murmur, Gram-Steele murmur, mid-systolic ejection murmur, pulmonary ejection sound, and finally a right ventricular fourth heart sound, a right ventricular third heart sound, which means the patient is going into severe congestive heart failure. The most important thing is not the loudness of the murmur. The most important thing is the distance, is the length of the murmur. So diastolic murmurs are, the severity of any diastolic murmur is by the length of that murmur. So if you find a very big distance between the second heart sound and the opening snap, it's not a severe disease. But if the distance between the second heart sound and the opening snap is short, that means the murmur is loud, the murmur is long, not loud, then that indicates severity of the disease. So severity of the disease, we go by the length of the murmur, the shortness of the time between the second heart sound and the opening snap, and evidence of congestive heart failure or evidence of pulmonary artery hypertension go in favor of clinically assessing the severity of the murmur. Opening snap, of course, classically occurs in mitral stenosis, but it can occur in so many other conditions, like you can hear it in mitral regurgitation, in VSD, second degree, third degree AV blocks. tricuspid atresia with a large ASD or even tetralogy of Fallot with a Bleylaktasik shunt. But classically, yes, if you hear an opening snap, then of course it is most likely mitral stenosis. Mid-diastolic murmur, best heard at the apex without any radiation, of course classically in mitral stenosis, but you can also hear it in flow murmurs across the mitral valve, like in VSD or a PDA where you got a lot of flow, or MR where you got a lot of flow across the mitral valve, or in severe AR, for example, on Austin Flynn murmur, where the jet of the AR jet impinges on the anterior mitral leaflet, causing it to get narrowed, or an LA myxoma, which is causing an obstruction of the mitral valve. And sometimes you may mistake a murmur for over the tricuspid valve as a mitral mid-diastolic rumbling murmur, like a tricuspid stenosis or an AST, a flow murmur of AST. So one must keep these things in mind when one is talking about a mid-diastolic murmur across the mitral valve. And if you have a look at the X-ray, which is very easily seen, we can see that the most important classical thing is there is the straightening of the left border. Normally if you see, there is an aortic knuckle, and then there is a conus, a pulmonary conus, a bay, an inward movement. But what happens is that in pulmonary artery hypertension, the bay becomes full, so it kind of, and then below that is the left atrial appendage, which also becomes very prominent. So this leads to a straightening of the heart. So you got the aortic knuckle, a prominent pulmonary conus, prominent left atrial appendage, and the left ventricle. They all form a straight line, which we call straightening of the left border of the heart. And one of the most important characteristics is to see for the left main bronchus. That I can't demonstrate it to here. Your practical teachers there have to demonstrate it to you. Is that the left bronchus becomes elevated, which signifies that the left atrium is getting enlarged. Also, we can see mitral valve calcification. We can see double contouring of the valve, because you can now see the LA and the RA borders. So that is double contouring. And finally, evidence of pulmonary venous hypertension in the sense of redistribution of the pulmonary veins. You can have curly B lines, you can have prominent transverse fissure, and so on. The extra feature in mitral stenosis is a myriad features: straight left border, full pulmonary conus, elevated left main bronchus, double right contour, mitral valve calcification, and evidence of pulmonary venous hypertension, curly B lines, prominent transverse fissure, and even finally pleural effusion. We can take a lateral view if you are interested in. Of course, we don't do it nowadays, but a lateral view will show you that right ventricle has become prominent. Left ventricle remains normal. The right ventricle has become prominent. So instead of the RV touching the lower thirds of the sternum, instead of the lower thirds of the sternum, you see it riding up and even touching two thirds of the sternum. So that would mean the RV is getting dilated. And finally, you can even do a barium swallow, or we used to do a barium swallow, in which we see indentation of the barium swallow by a dilated left atrium. But these two last two, the lateral views and the barium swallow, I don't think are done anymore after the advent of echocardiogram. As far as the ECG is concerned, most of the times the patient is in sinus rhythm, but sometimes they may develop atrial fibrillation, as I said, in about 30-40% of the cases. Over a period of time, they do develop atrial fibrillation. And the classical features would be left atrial enlargement, right atrial enlargement once the PH starts developing, right ventricular hypertrophy, and of course right axis deviation, all signifying the development of pulmonary artery hypertension. The classical feature would be that there would be no left ventricular hypertrophy, no features of left ventricular hypertrophy in a classical case of isolated mitral stenosis. And if you look at the ECG, we find in this ECG that there is somewhat right axis deviation. We find very deep inverted P waves in V1, which signifies a hugely dilated left atrium. We find the RSR dash pattern, which again signifies a prominent RV. And of course, we see a couple of ectopics also. That means the patient is not only having mitral stenosis, but probably having severe mitral stenosis. As far as cardiac catheterization is concerned, we don't do it anymore in patients with mitral stenosis. Echocardiography is more than sufficient for us to do an intervention procedure or to go ahead with surgery if the case so requires. But we do have some indications of doing a cath, especially if it's a male more than 40 years old, or a female more than 50 years old, or somebody who has potential risk factors for developing coronary artery disease, because if we are going to intervene, especially with surgery, we might as well do a CABG if required. So that is the whole intention of doing the cardiac cath. No more are we interested in doing a cardiac cath to diagnose a mitral stenosis. It has been totally taken over by echocardiography. Of course, the additional things that we can actually do is actually measure the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So we take a catheter and we actually wedge it into the pulmonary artery and we get a pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. We can even see a diastolic gradient across the mitral valve because we can measure this catheter which we have wedged in the pulmonary artery, and we are getting the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, and we put a catheter into the left ventricle. So we now have the left ventricular pressure and somewhat a measurement of the left atrial pressure, and we can actually get the gradient across the mitral valve. And of course, mitral valve area we used to calculate by the Gorlin formula. If you ask me what is the Gorlin formula, immediately I won't be able to tell you now, because now it's all changed. We are all doing it by echocardiography now. Yeah. So let's have a look at this trace. If you see this trace, we see that there is a big diastolic gradient. You can see, if you see the top one is the ECG, you see the P wave, the QRS complex, and you see immediately after the P wave, because electrical activity always occurs before the mechanical activity. So if you see correspondingly down, you see the very large tall A waves, a very large tall A wave, which is the hypertrophied left atrium trying to contract very vigorously, and you see the gradient and the across. That means you see the lower wave which is coming, which is the ventricular wave and the atrial wave. You can see that big gradient that is there across the mitral valve. So that's a classical thing that we see in a catheterization presentation. Now going back to mitral regurgitation, we can discuss in two forms. One is chronic mitral regurgitation, which is the very, very, very common presentation, and acute mitral regurgitation, which is an extremely dangerous condition. So as far as chronic mitral regurgitation is concerned, certain things have to be kept in mind. It's a gradual onset and gradual development, and it allows adaptation of the heart. So a patient may have a huge amount of mitral regurgitation, but may, other than palpitation, may not have any other feature and may go on merrily for years on end without any problem whatsoever. Not so with acute mitral regurgitation. The LA starts dilating, there's increase in compliance, the LV starts dilating and it maintains, but it keeps on maintaining a systolic forward flow. And even compensation occurs, even the patient can do even vigorous exercises for a long time, and it may last for many, many years. The highlight of what I'm saying is that it's a chronic process, it's a long duration process, it doesn't immediately impair the functional status of the patient, and the patient, but the heart keeps on dilating, the left ventricle atrium keeps on dilating. The patient may complain of some palpitation, some feeling of thudding sensation in the heart, but other than that, for many, many years, the patient may not have any other problem. Eventually what happens is that the volume overload occurs, the LV decompensation occurs, and ultimately the patient then starts getting into heart failure. Acute mitral regurgitation is totally different. It's almost as if it's a totally different entity, absolutely. There's an abrupt volume overload, and commonly we see it in two situations. The first situation is in an ischemic heart disease situation, in an infarct situation. That is what we commonly see. That's one common situation where we see acute mitral regurgitation. They're extremely sick patients, and the second situation we see it is infective endocarditis or a prosthetic valve malfunction. So we see acute mitral regurgitation. There is an abrupt volume has been dumped into the left atrium. The left atrium hasn't had any time to adjust itself. To this overload, and suddenly there is a fall in the forward stroke volume, and the increase in the left atrial pressure, and it immediately floods the pulmonary capillaries, and the patient goes into pulmonary edema. And unless treated vigorously and fast, and managed by a whole team of cardiologists and cardiothoracic surgeons, it is extremely and rapidly fatal. So there's a big difference between. So there is a big difference between the chronic mitral regurgitation and acute mitral regurgitation. The causes of chronic mitral regurgitation are myriad and rheumatic. Used to be, I think, one of the most prominent reasons, but now I think things are changing, and rheumatic heart disease perhaps. It may still be the largest amount, but is rapidly being overtaken by ischemic heart disease, perhaps mitral valve prolapse. We do see occasionally cases of Marfan syndrome. We see cases because of dilated cardiomyopathy, restrictive cardiomyopathy, even hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. They all have mitral regurgitation. Cleft mitral valve, which is a condition, congenital condition. SLE, rheumatoid arthritis, ankylosing spondylitis, and also prosthetic valve malfunctions. They can all cause chronic mitral regurgitation, acute mitral regurgitation, and we are seeing more and more of it recently, is ischemic heart disease, especially involving the posterior papillary muscle, because the posterior papillary muscle has a single supply. The PD artery is the only one which comes from the right coronary artery. So in an inferior wall infarction, you may have involvement of the PDA, involvement of the posterior papillary muscle, and the patient may develop acute mitral regurgitation. Whereas the anterior papillary muscle has dual supply, both from the LAD as well as from the OM, that is the circumflex, and therefore is not commonly involved. So anterior wall infarction with MR is less common than inferior wall infarction with acute MR, and you can have a very, very serious patient in your hand. Infective endocarditis with acute rupture and acute MR is also a possibility. Trauma, not very common, we don't see too much of that. And prosthetic valve malfunction, yes, if it is severe, if it is large, can also result in acute mitral regurgitation. How do we diagnose? The same process: history, physical examination, ECG, X-ray, echo. History, as I said, palpitation is the commonest, can go on for many, many years without causing any problems. And finally, they start getting breathlessness on effort. But as I said, we will come to echo criteria where we can even do surgery even before the patient actually becomes symptomatic. So just from palpitation to intervention could occur in patients with mitral regurgitation, whereas that is not probably the case with mitral stenosis. Of course, the patient may become breathlessness on effort, which is quite advanced and occurs late in the course of the disease, unlike mitral stenosis. And of course, they may progress to orthopnea, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, pedal edema. And of course, in acute, the presentation is breathlessness. The breathlessness, the clinical deterioration, hemodynamic deterioration of the patient in an acute mitral regurgitation will be dramatic in front of your eyes, and that will take, the physical findings will be far, far less than this dramatic presentation. So physically, what will we see when we examine the patient? Of course, the apex will be down and out, signifying that the left ventricle is dilated. It will be forceful, ill-sustained, again indicating that it's a regurgitant lesion. It's a hypertrophy with a regurgitant lesion. There might be a parasternal heave, signifying pulmonary artery hypertension, a palpable PA and a palpable P2, the same discussion that we had for mitral stenosis. Similarly, we can also have raised JVP, but mainly this time with the V waves, hepatomegaly, pedal edema, even hepatojugular reflux, and basal crepitations also. Physical examination, the first heart sound is soft. In mitral stenosis, it was loud. Here it is soft. We can hear a third heart sound prominently. We hear a pan-systolic murmur, which is best heard at the apex, and it often radiates to the axilla. Except in, for example, in an acute MR where the posterior papillary muscle is involved, it may radiate towards the base. But commonly, it radiates towards the apex. And of course, all the features of pulmonary artery hypertension, if it occurs, we can see loud pulmonary, loud P2, a Gram-Steele murmur, mid-systolic murmur across the pulmonary area, pulmonary ejection sound, right ventricle S4, and even a right ventricle S3 with the progression of the disease. We use certain maneuvers, especially in these cases, like leg elevation or isometric exercise. They all actually increase the murmur. So if we are in doubt, if you want to pick up early features of MR, soft murmurs, which we are not able to very clearly hear, thick chest wall patients, we can do these maneuvers. There are several maneuvers which we can do to increase our audibility of the murmurs. Mitral valve prolapse is a little bit different as far as clinical features are concerned. It may not be pan-systolic, it may be mid-systolic or even late-systolic or even be ejection-systolic murmur. It can be associated with single or multiple clicks. And sometimes we do certain maneuvers like a squat to stand maneuver. Sometimes if the patient is lying there for a long time before you examine, you may not hear any murmur. But if you ask the patient to squat and then you ask him to stand, you will definitely hear the accentuation of the systolic murmur. And so this is all slightly different from the usual features that we get in mitral regurgitation. So various maneuvers that we can do and are respiratory maneuvers, the Valsalva maneuver, exercise, positional changes, left lateral decubitus, and so on. And then whether the patient is having a premature atrial beat, pharmacological interventions that can be done, and even transient ocular occlusion by what we call leg elevation. When we elevate the leg, we call transient ocular. So all these are maneuvers that we do under various circumstances to enhance certain findings. The common findings for as far as mitral stenosis is concerned is we actually locate the apex with two fingers turn the patient to the left side, locate the apex with two fingers, and substitute, say, with the left hand, and substitute the two fingers with the bell exactly placed over that particular area. If after doing this exercise, and especially after we allow the patient to walk about, if after that we are not able to appreciate a mid-diastolic rumble, only then we can say that the patient does not have mitral stenosis. Because sometimes the mitral stenosis murmur can be very, very subtle. So the maneuver that we classically use in patients of mitral stenosis is exercise the patient, turn the patient in a left lateral decubitus, feel the apex with two fingers, and substitute with the bell over exactly that apex to hear that mid-diastolic rumbling murmur or to hear that opening snap. Whereas with mitral regurgitation, again we can exercise the patient or elevate the leg of the patient, turn the patient to the left side and hear it with the diaphragm. That is how we best hear the mitral regurgitation murmur. Acute mitral regurgitation, the most important thing is the clinical background. That means, can the patient have acute mitral regurgitation? Does the patient have ischemic heart disease? Has he had a recent infarct? Is the infarct of inferior wall infarct? And of course, it is of sudden onset. It comes on very, very suddenly and rapidly, and rapidly progresses to pulmonary edema with basal crepitation, severe breathlessness, tachycardia, tachypnea, and usually the heart size is normal because it hasn't had time to adapt. It has not dilated. Usually the heart size is normal. Murmurs may sometimes be harsh. Murmurs may sometimes even be very soft or even absent. So all these features may be present. They may even have an ejection quality, a harsh ejection quality. You may mistake it as an aortic stenosis murmur. Often it may radiate towards the base, again confusing you more with an aortic stenosis murmur. And S2 is widely spread simply because of the early A2. So there are classical differences. So mitral regurgitation, we can separate them as chronic mitral regurgitation with a special case of mitral valve prolapse, and acute mitral regurgitation in which the clinical findings will be totally different and from chronic mitral regurgitation. What about the ECG? Yes, most of them will be in sinus rhythm, but of course they can also have atrial fibrillation. It's very common because left atrial dilatation is the maximum and largest with mitral regurgitation, much more than we see in mitral stenosis. Left ventricular hypertrophy, especially with a volume overload pattern, a diastolic overload pattern or a volume overload pattern, is what we will classically see in mitral regurgitation. As I said, mitral stenosis does not have any LVH. We can have, of course, left atrial enlargement, right atrial enlargement, and right ventricular hypertrophy. So let's have a look at this ECG. Classically, if you look at the rightmost leads, the V4, V5, and V6 leads, we see very tall, high voltages signifying left ventricular hypertrophy, but we see that the T wave is also upright. It's tall and upright, and this shows that the patient is having a volume overload. It's not a systolic overload. It's not a pressure overload. And then we will start thinking that perhaps this patient has one of the volume overload syndromes, either MR or AR or VSD or PD or something like that. Whereas this is a classical ECG of a systolic overload pattern, which we will not see in patients with mitral regurgitation classically. We see the same tall voltages, but now we see the ST segment is depressed, the T wave is inverted. So this is not the classical feature that we will see in classical mitral regurgitation. What about the X-ray? Classically, the cardiothoracic ratio will be increased. So the heart size will be increased. This is not what we said for mitral stenosis. The mitral stenosis, the heart size may be normal or nearly normal, except there may be a prominence of the right atrial border when the right atrium starts dilating. What we said was the straightening of the left border of the heart. But here we are talking about dilatation of the heart as such, because the left ventricle dilates, the right, the RV dilates, the PA dilates, the RA dilates, everything dilates. So you've got a big heart. The left atrial appendage will of course dilate, the pulmonary conus will become prominent, there will be elevation of the left main bronchus because of left atrial enlargement, we will get evidence of pulmonary venous hypertension in the form of redistribution, prominent transverse fissure, curly B lines, all features, and even frankly, finally, pleural effusion also, and we may even see double contouring here. So the classically, that would be something of the heart that we will see in a patient of multiple valvular disease. You can see the aortic arch in the top, and then there's another little bump, which is probably the pulmonary conus, and then another third bump, which we call the third mogul or the left atrial appendage bump, and of course a very prominent left ventricle. We see similarly on the right side, the right atrium is very, very prominent, and also behind that we see pulmonary vasculature also, which is very, very prominent in this particular case. So those were the classical features that we saw in mitral stenosis as well as in mitral regurgitation. So to recapitulate. and summarize what we have just said is that mitral stenosis, there are so many there are only single cause actually. Rheumatic is the single cause. We have gone through the history and these physical findings, the classical physical findings, but again we have to confirm it with echocardiography, which as far as the rheumatic and valvular heart disease is concerned has become the pinnacle of even clinical examination. And mitral regurgitation, which we can classically subdivide and subclassify into chronic mitral regurgitation with a special case for mitral valve prolapse, and an acute mitral regurgitation, which is somewhat totally different from chronic mitral regurgitation in our approach and in our management. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tushar, for this descriptive description of the mitral stenosis as well as mitral regurgitation. Basically, the common understanding in regards to mitral stenosis is there is only single cause, as we assume, and in fact it is the all the symptoms are basically that blood is not able to enter into the left ventricle, and it is because of narrowing of this your mitral valve. These all these pressures are going backwards, and gradually the lung is overflowed by these all these fluids, and the symptoms gradually developed. Isn't it, Dr. Tushar?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely.
And in the same case, little bit differently, in the mitral regurgitation, blood is coming into the left ventricle, but while going into aorta, it's again going back towards the left atrium as well as towards the lung. So, but in this process, it is having some kind of adaptation in the case of chronic mitral chronic mitral regurgitation, where some kind of adaptation is occur. So there is a like left ventricular enlargement, left atrium enlargement, as well as some other changes we can find. So, but in case of acute mitral regurgitation, the entire pathophysiology is different, and that is why it is more dangerous, and it need urgent treatment, some kind of these things. So, these are the some basic fact that you have to remember. And although there are sophisticated diagnostic criteria like echocardiography and so, but before going into this, all of us, we have to very much particular about the history as well as our clinical examination, because there is a saying that your eyes cannot see what your mind doesn't know. So if you are not very clear with the pathophysiology, why it is occurring so, then you really cannot find like the loud first heart sound, there is an opening snap, there is a decrease or increase of your murmur, which indicates the severity of mitral stenosis, and all these things. That is why all of you has to be very clear with the pathophysiology, how this disease process is take on, and definitely all these things are towards the better management of the patient. So in this session we will stop here, and all of our students who are viewing this program here in studio as well as our regional centers, they can ask the questions through telephone or by fax, and we'll take next sessions after 15 minutes. Thank you very much.